All right, so let's talk about some cultural realities from the 1980s. This will be a very brief video. Now, when we talk about the 1980s, we talk about this is a decade known for its opulence, for its leisure, for its drug use. We even have the anti-drug campaign Just Say No, initiated by Nancy Reagan, which became kind of a joke to many at the time. We have the rise of the yuppies, the young urban professionals. These replaced hippies as the centerpiece of American culture. They helped to promote the consumerism of the decade, which would help economic prosperity develop as well. It is during this time also the movie Wall Street would come out, and a guy named Gordon Gekko, who is the major character, his famous quote, "Greed is good, greed is right." Now, for some, this decade is the decade of greed. Because there is economic prosperity. Some people are making more money than they've ever made before. And there is significant opportunity for many. So we have that, the movie Wall Street. We have something called The Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous. This would be a popular television show, which just showed how rich and famous people lived. Today we have reality TV. It's all over the place. They follow this on their own. But back then, this was kind of a new thing. And again, it kind of shows the focus on material gain. Another episode, if you will, or another thing from the 80s, which shows this focus on materialism, the song Material Girl by Madonna. This was a quite popular song, but more importantly, I think it reflected the materialism of the decade. It is kind of funny to listen to Madonna talk these days and how she acts like she's a populist when very much she embraced materialism and wealth and this ostentatious display of wealth as well. During this time, we also have the rise of cable television, provided a whole new avenue of leisure for Americans. Now we have MTV. It used to actually play music videos, kind of hard to believe. We have sports channels, all sports channels. We have nonstop news channels, which would impact our ability to gain more information. This is really the dawning of the information age, because we also see computers come at this time, really become more popular. Popular music exploded with the advent of music television. Kids could now watch videos all day and night. They could learn about new artists. They could enjoy their favorites. They saw artists made a big difference in their rising popularity, for example, Madonna. But it could also hurt one's potential. There was a band called the John Cafferty Beaver Brown Band. They sounded just like Springsteen. They were very American. They had some great songs, but they never became popular because, well, they didn't quite look the part. They weren't very attractive. They were the band that played the music in the movie Eddie and the Cruisers, which was quite popular in the 80s. But again, their music sounded just like Springsteen, who really was no different than the other American artists at the time. But again, he wasn't attractive. Another thing that we see at this time, we have Reagan and the conservative coalition in power. So we have to have a reaction, right? And in music, we have punk music would explode in many ways, taking advantage of MTV. We have bands like The Clash, The Minutemen, Husker Du become more well-known through these avenues. Hardcore acts take a more political stance, arguing against Reagan and the rising conservatism. Even punk bands like the Dead Kennedys would get into politics. They had a song called Holiday in Cambodia. They had an album called Plastic Surgery Disasters, which raged against materialism. And they had an album called In God We Trust, Inc., which, of course, was critical of the religiosity of the time. Their album Bedtime for Democracy, which, again, argued that we were no longer a democratic nation. The band Bad Brains, I call the godfathers of hardcore. They were an African-American hardcore band from Washington, D.C. They mixed in reggae, but they were very political, very intense. I highly recommend you find, like, the song Band in D.C. is a great song. Bad Religion, a California punk band, was led by a PhD in philosophy who taught at Berkeley. These were not lyrics with no thought behind them. They were aggressive and educated youths who had something to say. Now, the power of Reagan made it only more palpable. Fugazi, a D.C. hardcore band, would take on social issues. They came from the band Minor Threat, a legend in D.C. hardcore. Fugazi, though, toward the end of the 80s, would take on social issues, so it wasn't as much political. They would take on women's rights in support of it, obviously. Abortion rights, things like that. Again, social issues, not so much political, but they made the personal political, which is something we've talked about. We also have bands like the Circle Jerks, the Butthole Surfers, who sought comic relief and shocked people. The band Suicidal Tendencies, Jodie Foster's Army, MDC, named Million Dead Cops, These are bands that also deserve mention. They were pretty revolutionary at the time. But again, it shows you kind of the consistency of themes in American history, that we have a band called Million Dead Cops in the 1980s. And we see some antipathy toward police here in 2017 as well. Now, alienation would play out in bands like Sonic Youth, which I would call industrial punk rock. With the rise of computers, we also have new sounds. Techno music would begin to forge its own path. This would climax in the 1990s with techno dance music. And part of this were the raves, the rave culture, dropping ecstasy, going to the raves, and just partying all night. Rap and hip-hop would gain steam as well. Bands like Public Enemy provide a new avenue toward black power and identity through music. If you are not familiar with Public Enemy, I would highly recommend you check them out, specifically the song Fight the Power. NWA and similar bands rap about being African-American and the struggle that black youth face. Run DMC sets a new standard for hip-hop, rapping about different themes than what we previously hear in pop music. Now, this music, this era of hip-hop, is not about jewelry or sex. It is about identity and empowerment. Even have the Beastie Boys appropriating the music of African-Americans. And they actually start as a hardcore band. These are Jewish youths from New York City who have an excellent history as well in hip-hop. Now, nostalgia and fascination with the 1960s also comes during the 1980s. This may be because 1987 was the 20-year anniversary of the Summer of Love, but the music and the clothing became the fashion. I remember going to college and seeing people dressed up like hippies, and of course, the only thing I thought was, those clothes were ugly in the 60s, and they are still ugly. Fortunately, this was a fad that did not last too long. We also see a revival of 60s music like the Grateful Dead, Bob Dylan, Janis Joplin. We also see an uptick in activism. Now, we have family-oriented television shows which come back, and they take on actual issues. Shows like The Cosby Show, Family Ties, Roseanne, and Married with Children each have their own style. Roseanne focused on a blue-collar family that struggled to make it. Cosby portrayed a successful professional African-American man and his family. Married with Children was a satire on family life and many of the hot-button issues in the nation at the time. Family Ties was rather watered down, but somewhat enjoyable. Movies like The Big Chill shared some of the disillusionment of the baby boomer generation with the fallout from the 1960s, but also showed that these hippies and activists had now become yuppies. And in many ways, this bought into and took advantage of the system. Computers begin to infiltrate the American home as well, providing new ways to garner information and communicate with others. These would revolutionize everything about our lives, how we communicate, how we shop, how we glean information. This was certainly a revolution on par with the invention of the movable type and the printing press centuries previous. So we have leisure and entertainment options abound. We have cable TV. We have VCRs. Again, this may seem like antiquated to some of you, but this was the first time you could actually watch a movie when it wasn't just on TV or in the theater. You could rent a movie and watch it at your own leisure. Again, this was somewhat revolutionary for many of us. And consumerism was rampant. People spent money. They bought stuff. But again, that goes with the prosperity of the decade. If people aren't buying things, then people aren't making money, right? People don't have jobs. So it is all part of a large cycle. We often hear a lot of criticism about consumerism, but again, in a capitalist nation, that is integral to our success. So this was considered, again, the decade of greed or the decade of me. But was it truly? Consider that contributions to charitable organizations were higher during this decade than any previous decade. Yes, some people made a lot of money, but these same people often gave this money to those who needed it. We also have, again, some social activism. It's not all about me. It's about helping others, especially with regard to musicians and college students. We have a group of shows which go to help the poor and needy. We have Live Aid, USA for Africa, which had the song We Are the World, the US Festival. We even have Sun City, which is anti-apartheid actions, as many artists refused to play in South Africa until apartheid was abolished. So we have a record on Sun City by Little Steven, who would be in the Sopranos show later on. But so activism, it's not just a decade of me. It is a recognition that there's plenty else going on. But that is the 80s right there.